लिखा है अल्फा हेलिक्स के लिए?
ना ना ना, सो अल्फा हेलिक्स 3.6 एंगस्ट्रॉम पर कंप्लीट टर्न एंड 13 एटम्स आर इन्वॉल्वड बिटवीन द हाइड्रोजन बॉन्ड फॉर्मिंग एटम्स. ओके ओके. एंड इन 310 हेलिक्स, ओके, इट्स कॉल्ड लिटरली 310 हेलिक्स, 3 नैनोमीटर फॉर कंप्लीट टर्न एंड 10 एटम्स आर इन्वॉल्वड इन नो नो
सर आई थिंक
आई एम गेटिंग कंफ्यूज्ड. या या मित्रदीप,
आई थिंक इट्स 3 रेसिड्यूज पर टर्न.
सॉरी या या, सो लेट मी ओपन दैट क्लास लेक्चर. ओके, सो आई थिंक वी हैव नोटेड डाउन देयर. या सॉरी या, सो 3 okay, I'm trying to open. Okay, so I hope I have scanned picture of that, right? So this one. Ah, sorry. So number of residues is So this one. Okay. Okay, Shubhra, this clarifies. So three alpha helix are 3.6, 13 helix shown here. Okay, so let me see my laser point. How do you get laser point? Slideshow. How do you get the laser pointer here? Okay.
Arrow options, right click and arrow options. Pointer options, arrow options.
Pointer options, arrow options. Okay, it says automatic visible hidden. I don't see laser. I know you. Okay. Yeah, but anyway, so okay, where are we? Okay, so so if you see the alpha helix, it's a right-handed helix I'm showing. So this is 3.613 helix. So 3.6 is meaning is 3 point residues make one complete turn. Let's say if you have to make 10 complete turns, so then it is 36 residues. So for one turn, 3.6 residues. And each residue provides 1.5 angstroms along the axis of the helix. So then 3.6 helix is basically 5.4 angstrom for one complete turn. And 13 is because the hydrogen bond forming amide and carbonyl, if you connect between this oxygen and the hydrogen along the backbone, so you have actually 13 atoms. Okay, this is called 13 atoms forming the loop. That's why it is 3.613. On the other hand, 310 helix, so it's 3 residues complete one turn. Okay, that's very clear actually when you see polypropylene. And 10 atoms are actually connecting the loop between the atoms forming hydrogen bond. Okay, Shubhra, this picture is clear? Okay.
Yes, sir. From this picture, only I was telling that in this alpha helix, it seems like 4 residues are there.
No, what do you mean 4 residues? You can really literally see the numbers, right? The E is showing 1 oxygen to 12 nitrogen and hydrogen is 13. So you, the alpha helix, you have 13 atoms.
Yes, sir, and, 13 atoms.
And 310 helix, it's actually 10 atoms. So 1 to 9 is nitrogen and 10 is hydrogen.
But but how 3.6?
No, no, 3.6 is basically, that's why I'm showing the other picture. Okay, so I'm showing for the alpha helix picture. Alpha helix picture, if you see, so on the left side, nicely shown transparent cylinder and then helix on the outer surface, right? So you see, starting at 1, okay, two, 1 is on the other side of the cylinder from you, and then 3 is in front of cylinder, right? But 1 to 3 doesn't really complete one turn. But if you see the 4, okay, so then our 5, it's already more than this, you know. So it's basically 3.6 per atoms. No, sorry, 3.6 residues per complete turn. So if you write 10 turns, then you have actually 36 residues.
Okay, per turn we are talking.
Not atoms, sorry. Residues. Okay. Atoms will be much more. Yeah. Is it clear or not?
Yes, sir. Per turn we are calculating. Okay.
Yes. Per turn means one complete turn. Okay. So you start on one position on cylinder and then walk along the helix. So you come back and finish one complete turn on the cylinder. Okay, who's next?
Sir, I have a question regarding the sDNA. Can you please go back to the slide, sDNA?
sDNA, different types of DNA. So, okay, I need to remember. So that's before this, I guess, right? Okay, so. S is basically stretched DNA, right? Okay.
Yes, sir, in that slide. In that slide.
Yeah.
In okay. this loop, we first can see that with the slight increase in the force, there occurs extension in DNA. Then with the increase in force, we can see there is a very slight increase in the DNA length, and then there occurs uncoiling in this case. So why in the starting of the curve? When we are applying certain no forces, there is increasing length. It is because of the AT base pairing is unwinding, and then it is the portion saying the GC.
Sujit, are you there?
Sir, can you please repeat that? I lost you in that.
No. I couldn't actually hear your question. So my connection from home, sometimes it's a problem. Could you repeat your question?
I am repeating that.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. In the sDNA, if we look at this curve, then we can see that in the starting of the point, there is almost no forces, there occurs some elongation. And then afterward, when we are applying the forces, then there occurs almost no increase in the DNA length, and then there occurs uncoiling, and it becomes mostly a single-stranded DNA. Mm. So in the first, at the starting point, when the force applied is very small, then significant extension is. Is it because the AT base pairing is unwinding in that case? And in the rise, when this is base pairing is rising the curve, is it the portion showing the GC base pairing, which is much more stronger than AT? Is it that signifying?
No. So this experiment is called force versus extension. So as shown on the cotton picture on the left side, so you have actually a long double-stranded DNA. So these are typically a micron long double-stranded DNA. So you have like a lot of base pairs. Okay, so once you stretch that, okay, so what's happening is that initially, what do you see on the curve, force versus extension? So initially, it's the force is rising, but the extension, initial flat curve is actually along linearization, you know? So even if it is double-stranded DNA, like I said, it's 1,000 base pairs in these experiments. So sir. Even the double stranded DNA itself is actually coil. Okay.
Okay.
So it's like a clump together, a globule. Okay. But then now you actually linearize that double stranded DNA. Okay.
Okay,
shown in the cartoon. So that itself actually takes initial elongation. That's really occurring. Say below 5 piconewton. So that's basically just elongation of coiled double-stranded DNA into linear double-stranded DNA.
Okay,
means that in this, even at this stage at 5 piconewton, all base pairs are intact. Okay, whether it is AT or GC, all base pairs are intact. But okay, let's say from 5 piconewton to let's say 60 piconewton, you see there is a sharp raise.
Yes, sir.
But during that raise, force is changing a lot. Almost is actually going from 5 to 65 piconewton.
Yes, sir.
If you see the extension, relative extension is not really that much. Okay,
yes,
it's going maybe 0.275 to or 0.3 to 0.35.
Yes, sir.
0.3 to 0.35 nanometer per base pair. So during this time, okay, so again, very little change, though it is extensible, okay? So it's basically, you take any rope, you know, so any telephone wire or anything. So initially, it's very easy to elongate. But though it is actually very close to linear, but to make it perfect linear, you need to extend very little, right?
Yes, sir.
But force required to linearize that is much higher.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so that's why the force is actually going from 5 to 65. Even during that stage, no base pairs are being disrupted.
Okay.
Almost up to 65, up to let's say 0.38 nanometer per base pair on the x-axis.
But so, here is the question. Here the, we are seeing getting that almost a sharp rise in this case. Is there the hydrogen bonding interaction and the base
stacking? No interactions such as hydrogen bonding between base pairs is not affected.
Yes, sir. That's what I'm saying.
Yeah, it's not affected.
Is that the preventing the elongation?
No. The two questions. You divide questions into two parts. One, am I breaking any bonds? No.
Yes, sir.
You are not breaking any base pair interactions. Okay, but then how do you explain the extension? So this is called entropic elasticity. Even if you take any random polymer, okay? So typically it wants to be in clump state. But let's see, you want to make it perfectly linear, okay?
Then
very close to the linear, a little extension, okay, to make it completely linear, you require much higher force to overcome basically entropic conformational cost, okay?
What is
entropy? Okay, so let's see if you take a molecule, okay, very flexible bonds, okay, 1,000 monomer in the form of a polymer. All bonds are flexible, they can actually bend, okay, dihedrals can go, let's say, very close to, let's say, 30, 40, 0, whatever it is, okay? But let's see if you take millions of those molecules in solution, and if you measure end-to-end distance, okay? So let's say each monomer length is, an angstrom. So then the contour length will be 1,000 angstroms, all right? So 1,000 angstroms is actually its linear structure. So how many molecules will have a length of 1,000 angstrom from end to end? Very few, because all want to clump together because of entropy.
Yes, sir.
So if all are linear, then entropy is zero.
Yes, sir.
But then they want to really clump together, form a globule structure so that they can actually, individual molecule can attain a different conformation. So you have a lot more conformations, means entropy is high, so the system is stabilized.
Okay, sir.
Now you want to make all molecule linear, so then you need to spend energy so that you keep them in linear state where actually entropy cost you provide by extending. Exactly what's happening here in double-stranded DNA. Up to 65 piconewton, you are not breaking any bonds. Okay, but 0 to 5 piconewton, it looks almost linear at 5 piconewton. But 5 to 65, that small change, okay, at the cost of temperature. Basically, temperature wants make it to globule, but then force wants to make it linear. So there is a fight between force and temperature.
Okay, sir.
And then that's why force, so the higher the force, then it will win against temperature. But yes, at 65, once it becomes linear double-stranded DNA, it's like a stiff rod. Now, if you want to extend any further, okay, you need to really break these interactions between the base pairs so that further increase in the extension can be gained. So that's why at the 65 piconewton, once you continue again extending, base pairs are actually breaking one at a time, but each base pair actually gives you nice extension. Okay.
Yes, sir.
So that's why it's flat. The force is constant at 65. Then extension goes 0.35 to, let's say, 0.6 per base pair. Means that almost twice the length, okay, per base pair. Provided because of the base pairing, it's actually in the helical thing this become, but now it becomes linear. So that extension increases dramatically, but at the same force. But once all base pairs actually broken, so then you have actually two, imagine a parallel DNA strands parallel to each other, but without any base pair stacking.
Yes, sir.
Now, if you try to extend that further, then you are actually playing dihedrals within the individual molecules. Okay, again, whose entropy you are playing. So that's why mostly that ssDNA after, let's say, 0.6 nanometer for base pair, your again, force increases, but gain in the length is less.
Okay.
So this is called entropic elasticity. So there are two regimes. You can actually divide this graph. Entropic regime, where actually 0 to 65 piconewton force, where actually no bonds are being broken, or in other words, no enthalpy is spent.
Okay. Sir.
But at 65, 0.35 nanometer base pair to 0.6, force is constant. On the entire strand, but the individual stacking is disrupted, so enthalpic cost. But once all the hydrogen bonds are broken, now again entropic part comes, but this entropic part is on single stranded DNA.
Yes sir, got it.
Okay, good. Who is next question?
So I have one question. So
Who is this?
Sir Suman Tiwari.
Yeah, Suman. Okay.
Sir, in Leninger textbook, there's a term written, hydration of the non-polar group. So I don't understand what does it mean by hydration of the non-polar group, because we have studied about hydration of the ions in the water.
Correct. Okay. So that's actually, I would cover in what is called hydrophobic collapse. Okay. So where even if you put, let's say, hydrophilic groups, if you put it in aqueous medium or to be, are in water. So then because these are hydrophilic, so they love water. So water also wants to actually share its hydrogen bonds with these molecules. Okay. So how does water molecule actually share its hydrogen bonds? So if there is no other solute is there in water, so water molecule, accepts water molecules, oxygen accepts two hydrogens as hydrogen bonding, and also it donates two hydrogens as hydrogen bond donor. So total each water molecule has on an average four hydrogen bonds, right? But now imagine you start putting solutes in solution, okay, and let's say these are dispersed individual solute molecules, then the water molecules on the surface, okay, so the atoms which are on the surface of this solute will not be able to form hydrogen bond with other water molecules. So somehow the water needs to satisfy these hydrogen bonds of on an average four hydrogen bonds if solute is there. Okay. So if the solute is hydrophilic and if it has hydrogen donating capacity or it has hydrogen accepting capacity, so then water satisfies. That's not a problem. That's why actually solutes are soluble. But however, if you try to put small amounts of hydrophobics, okay, let's say a benzene or phenol or naphthalene, so they are sparingly soluble, okay? But yet, if you see the water coordination around these hydrophobic molecules, okay, because they don't like water, they try to separate themselves. But now the water molecules will not be able to satisfy their hydrogen bonds because the solute has no way, either can donate or accept hydrogen as hydrogen bond, etc. donor. So then water will actually have very funny conformations around these solutes. Okay. And so the orientation itself, okay, so will be different than hydrophilic solvents. So this specific orientation comes at entropic cost, okay, means organized. So these are actually organized water molecules on the surface of a hydrophobic solute. That's actually entropic cost, okay, so because there is an order involved. So this actually I'll discuss in detail when I talk about hydrophobic collapse.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Otherwise, solubilizing hydrophobic solutes have a very funny arrangement of water molecules on the surface of solutes because their orientation needs to satisfy on an average 4 hydrogen bonds. For that requirement, they'll be much more organized on hydrophobic solutes. Okay, at the cost of entropic cost. Okay.
Okay, and so I have a general question. Yeah. So suppose we have insulin and yeah. we, in a beaker, we have all the amino acids which we require to synthesize insulin and we somehow synthesize insulin, but we haven't controlled the folding of the protein.
Yeah. yeah.
So there are many possible ways in which the proteins can fold. There are many like thermodynamics associated with it. So is it like the insulin that is present in the biological system is the most thermodynamic conformation of that peptide sequence, or there are many others, other thermodynamic, thermodynamically stable adaptations, but that insulin which we obtain in biological system is the preferred one?
Okay, so first of all, folding of proteins cannot be generalized too much. Means that certain proteins can fold on their own, okay, inside the cell after they are synthesized. So they don't require any additional assistance, okay, for folding. But occasionally, either some proteins, especially large proteins, they do not really fold on themselves. They need assistance. So this assistance inside the cell comes through the molecules called chaperones. There are different classes of chaperones inside the cell. Their job is to assist protein folding. Let's say protein is synthesized, but yet it did not somehow achieve its native conformation so that it cannot really function. So then chaperones somehow assist these proteins. They recognize somehow the misfolded proteins or not folded proteins, and then they give a chance for them to refold. So some proteins, the way they do is that they have a large hydrophobic chamber, okay? So these are like football-shaped molecules, empty shell, okay, inside. So somehow they gulp these unfolded protein molecules inside the football-shaped thing, do some magic, okay, with the help of ATP energy converted into conformational changes into mechanical energy. And the molecule inside the football or inside the chaperone has multiple cycles of rupturing a conformation so that it will allow it to fold itself. So multiple cycles of ATP somehow let this molecule fold. Once the molecule is folded inside this hydrophobic chamber, now the chaperone actually let out the molecule. So it will take another molecule, unfolded molecule, and then through converting ATP chemical energy into mechanical energy, let this protein fold. So on and so forth, these chaperones can help molecules which are either not folded or misfolded in intracellular environment so that these molecules can fold so that their function, they can attain their function. But most of the small protein molecules don't require, but whenever it is required, it's coming. Okay, so insulin, you know, so it's synthesized in beta cells, okay, as a single polypeptide chain. But insulin has a complex property that it has actually disulfides. Okay, so it has actually disulfides. Not only it forms disulfide, I think that should be outside the cell, but there are actually enzymes which cleave this polypeptide chain after disulfide bond is formed, so that so in the end you have actually two separate polypeptide chains covalently linked through two disulfide bonds, if I remember correctly. Okay, so the folding of insulin is slightly different than the folding of intracellular molecules. And so to address your questions, that for example, let's say circulating insulin in our circulating systems in blood, do these molecules have a variety of conformations? Because insulin is slightly multi-chain molecule at the end, okay? So the single chain is called proinsulin, okay? And then after the disulfide bond is formed, there is a cleavage occurs. And then so that in the end, you have two peptides cross-linked through disulfide. So that's called insulin. And then, they might have slightly different conformations. But what's the function of insulin? So insulin actually, depending on the blood sugar, so it will actually allow cells to absorb. If there is a lot of sugar in blood, it will make cells absorb. The way it does is that there are insulin receptors on your cells. So insulin actually goes and binds this insulin receptor, and then it induces transmembrane signaling. So the signal goes to the other side of the membrane. So somehow you have glucose importers. So this insulin receptor, once binding insulin, tells inside the cell that you have to take now glucose inside. So then it recruits glucose importers into membrane so that glucose in the blood or outside the cell will be allowed inside the cell. So yeah, insulin might have slightly different conformations, okay? But that depends on chain to chain, size of the molecule, environment, where is a protein molecule. So like I said, but the protein molecules are in the circular systems. I don't think you have any chaperones there to help. So if the protein is not functional, it will be soon taken out easily because it's in the circulating system. Okay, if it doesn't bind insulin receptor, it's not functional. But inside the molecule, these molecules will have a chance to refold. But after multiple cycles, if they're not really getting their shape, native state, so then they'll be put into either lysosomal and compartment so that there is pH-induced denaturation and proteolysis, or ubiquitin-mediated protein degradation. So there are two ways, actually. You can selectively recycle these molecules. Okay, next question.
That's it.
Yeah, okay, sure.
So okay. I have a question.
Yeah, Mitradeep, yeah.
So I have a question regarding the protein folding that we were discussing.
Yeah.
So let's say each of the peptide bond has a small dipole, right?
Peptide, yes. Peptide is a dipole, it has a direction.
So let's say I have a certain secondary structure, let's say alpha helix or beta sheet.
Okay.
And considering that the side chains really do not play any role in the tertiary folding, can the peptide backbone ka dipole be strong enough such that it goes into a certain tertiary structure?
For example, let's say when it formed alpha helix, so side chains do not really, I mean, we are talking about individual alpha helix. For example, let's say polyalanine or something.
Yes.
So where, because of the hydrogen bond interactions, the stabilization really occurs. Okay, there is something called helix propagation. Okay, so there is a transient helix nucleation site, means that 1-2, I2I+4, there is a one hydrogen bond forming. If that helix can be strengthened further by further hydrogen bonding to lengthen the helix, if that is possible, then the helix propagates. But if that's not possible, then this transient nucleation actually will break.
Okay.
Okay. So in that sense, it's difficult to say that, of course, when we study secondary structure separate from tertiary structure. And then secondary structure, we characterize mainly where well-defined canonical structures like helices and sheets, because whose structural properties are well-known. But there could be transient interactions like beta hairpin, okay, or helix nucleation. These are transient, but unless they are supported further, so they will not propagate. Okay.
No, my question is not that. So helix, let's say a helix, it itself is a dipole, right?
Correct.
So can, let's say, multiple helices, just only due to the dipole nature, I'm not considering any side chain interactions.
Oh, okay. Can come together.
They form certain kind of second tertiary structure.
Okay.
Let's say even beta sheets. So can due to the dipolar property of the peptide bond, can they form certain tertiary structure? If I have a defined secondary structure for them, I'm assuming the secondary structure is defined.
I think it's not possible because the moment tertiary structure, when you use the word tertiary structure, imagine let's say two helices are independently, they are there, but they need to come together, interact. That's what is the meaning of tertiary structure, right?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. So the moment they are actually brought together in whatever your orientation. So now the side chains are actually very important, right? So because because now if you see the space field model, so side chains will have a lot more. Overlap. Okay, so let me see. So if you see, this is a space filling model. Okay. So where, let me see, where is the side chain is not really shown on the C. I wanted to see on the C. Panel C, side chains are not represented, right?
Side chains are the yellow ones, I think, in panel C. They're like single.
Okay, atoms. So only single atom is shown. Okay. Now imagine this is only, even if it is methyl, okay, means alanine, then you have other three hydrogens are involved on this yellow sphere, right? Okay, yes. But if it is any other side chain other than glycine alanine, then you have large. So now imagine you bringing two helices, brought together. Mm. Okay, in whichever way orientation now, side chains actually begin to interact, right?
Okay.
So the side chains, even if they're not really charged, so then you have weak van der Waals interaction. But now if side chains will have, let's say, charges and etc., then you have electrostatic much stronger. So even if you have weak van der Waals interactions, okay, I believe those will be much more stronger than your dipole. You're talking about the dipole of the helix.
Yes.
Okay, so there is a dipole of the helix because the peptide bond is actually oriented and there is a weak dipole. So I would presume that this a large dipole of the helix versus another large dipole of the helix is not really strong enough than the side chain interactions, which will be coming into picture the moment you overlap the moment you bring in two helices. I think that's my answer. And it's the same thing with beta sheets.
Okay.
Okay. Because imagine if it doesn't have any side chains, okay, for example, like glycine. So then you won't have, but glycine will form actually much more compressed structure than even alpha helix.
Okay.
So structures are different. Okay.
So I have one question.
Yes. Mitradeep, yes. Sorry, Suman. Mitradeep, are you through with your question? Mitradeep?
This is a question. I had another question comparing DNA to protein.
Okay, quickly ask. Suman will come back to you.
Yes, sir. I can wait. Yeah.
Okay, so the question is that, let's see, if I consider the alpha helix,
okay,
versus if I consider the DNA double stranded structure, both are like helical structures.
Correct.
But for alpha helix, I understand that there is hydrogen bonding and that is causing the stabilization of this helical structure.
Correct.
But for DNA, what is the motivating factor that is, what is the interaction that is causing it to become a helix?
Yeah. So two interactions. Okay. So mainly stacking of the bases. Okay. So base stacking means that on the same strand, okay, one base is above the other. Okay. So that interaction between the bases is stabilizing. And the sideways interaction with the other base on the other helix. So through hydrogen bonding. Okay. So now So you may, you are thinking that why it needs to be helix? Why can't it be just ladder? Ladder of,
yeah,
okay?
Exactly.
Okay. So now you have to bring in the conformation of the backbone of DNA. What is there on the backbone? So you have sugar is there on the backbone, right? So if you see the sugar actually constrains your chain. Okay. So the sugar on the backbone, okay, so shown in blue and yellow. Okay, so the sugar, because of this structure, okay, so this connectivity, the glycosidyl connectivity with the phosphate, it restricts its conformations. Okay, so what is shown here, all the single bonds, okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay, so these are the bonds along which actually you can try to modulate this. Okay, and if you see the sugar, the base is attached here, but the sugar itself is 5-member. So it cannot, it has its own conformational restrictions, okay? On how exactly the chain onto the previous phosphate versus the next phosphate, how it's connected. So this restriction will not allow you to form the stack, okay?
But these are like single bonds, right? So they should be free rotating.
Exactly. So now let's say if you straighten this as much as possible along this axis, so then the stacking will not be possible. So then stacking, the stacking means that the distance between the two base pairs on the same chain will be higher.
Okay,
because of that increase in the gap, once you linearize, so that is not stabilizing. So they need to brought together somehow on the same chain. Okay, let me put it like this. Sorry, I need to show on the both hands on the same thing. Okay, like this. Okay, so now, so if they are on the linearized, the spacing is larger, stacking is not occurring, but that's because the connection on the backbone between these two bases, so is basically lengthened. Now it needs to be shortened. The moment you try to shorten, there is a rotation occurs. So like this. So because of that rotation, okay, so the base pairs are stacked, but they're at an angle.
Yeah.
Okay, so that angle for every pair, if you increase, that gives the handedness and also helicity in the end. So yes, your question is that, let's see, if you have to make ladder, it's possible, but then you won't have a base pair, stacking is absent. Okay, stacking interaction on the basis on the same strand is absent. But however, hydrogen bond is satisfied on the other strands. But this is not a stable conformation, because the moment it will find there that now if I change the relative orientation slightly at the expense, so now actually they can stack better. So then the more or less they will be locked there. So it's the reason is because of the constraints. Okay, how many atoms are there between the bases along the backbone? That's basically phosphodiester bond connecting through the sugar restricts the way the bases on the same strand can stack. That's
okay. So just if you can give me some numerical idea.
Okay.
Yeah. So the stacking energy, how large or small is that compared to, let's say, KT or something?
No, it's much more higher. I think that's basically, this experiment will tell you that. Okay. So imagine, see, at the linear strands, okay, so what's really happening? So the strand is linearized. This is exactly what you wanted. You wanted two linearized strands, okay, extended strands, so that the bases are exactly perpendicular.
Yes,
right,
but I want the base pairing preserved as well.
No, so then it will not be possible unless you bring in some other stabilizing factor. Okay, because this is a hydrophobic. If you see the bases, okay, bases, if you see, these are on either side of the base is hydrophobic. Okay,
yes.
So imagine it's like a sheet. On either side it's actually hydrophobic, but only across the strand on the plane you can form hydrogen bond. So though you are able to satisfy the hydrogen bond with other base pair, but on either side now you have a stacked base pair, but it's actually hydrophobic on either side. So how do you actually stabilize that? You have to bring in other hydrophobic element. Okay. So, but now you asked me that question. So in the tetraplexes, okay, it's possible that you can, in principle, again, bring in this kind of orientation. Okay. So orientation can be slightly, between the stacks, which can actually change the orientation. That's possible in tetraplexes, but not in duplexes. Okay. Yeah.
Thank you.
Sir, yeah. In this question, in this idea, you said that when it comes closer, it gets kind of tilted or what? That I couldn't understand.
No. So you see in this picture, okay, so the base pairs are, they are one over the other. That's why it's called stack, one over the other. So that's why it's stack. But this is not like a pack of cards, okay, where deck of cards, you can put one over the other perfect in register, right? That's what is Mitradeep's question. Why can't I have a structure like this? My answer to that was, yes, imagine, let's see if that is needs to form, because they cannot really be at any distance, they won't, because they are connected along the backbone, right? So that backbone actually restricts. The moment you want them to be in register, then the distance is slightly long enough that there is no interaction between the bases. But if you want to allow the interactions, then the backbone actually relaxes through, let's say, some dihedrals along the single bonds. And then, but the slight orientation occurs. But this orientation actually reduces the distance between the base pairs. The bases. Because of this change in the, or reduction in the distance, the interaction is allowed to happen, but yes, at the cost of slight angle with respect to each other. Now, yes, bring in another base, which is slightly another oriented in slightly different angle. So that will give you helicity.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay, Suman, you had a question?
Yes, sir. So I had a question like, we have certain globular proteins which are positively charged and some which are negatively charged. While we were studying the structure of proteins, we were accounting for the interaction of the charges to the oppositely charged groups. Yes, we have positively charged amino acids and negatively charged amino acids, but in the tertiary structure, we were in total accounting for the net stability of the charges. So how we get these residual charges onto the proteins, like some are positively and some are negatively charged. If we accounted for the balancing of the charges while there were protein foldings.
No. I think it's depending on, it's not necessary that the entire molecule needs to be neutral. Okay. So, and very often proteins are not entirely neutral. So they have what is called, you can actually measure what is called isoelectric point. Means that pH at which they are neutral. So typically they are not in the physiological range. Sometimes they are in the acidic, sometimes in the basic. Means that there is a net positive charge or negative charge on an average. Net positive charge means that assume there are maybe more lysines and arginines compared to aspartic acid and glutamic acid. Or if it is entirely net negatively charged, then you have more aspartic and glutamic acids compared to this. Okay. What is your question? So it's not necessary.
What sort of interactions lead to the localization of the charges onto the surface of the proteins? Like the charged entities should be on the surface of the proteins. Like we have histone proteins, which are positively charged and which bind to the DNA, which is negatively charged.
Yes.
So if you're accounting for the interactions, like you told hydrogen bonding and then ion-ion interactions. Wait. So what sort of interaction ensures the charge to be located on the surface? Means how are the amino acids localized onto the surface?
Yeah. So, but let's say if you take histone proteins without DNA, so then their charges are not satisfied by other side chains in the protein. No. So they are actually positive charges of lysines are sticking outside. So they are actually either neutralized by counter-ions in water. Okay. But not counter ions are called oppositely charged groups coming from the same molecule. So there is, it's not necessary that the site change, especially on the surface. The reason is they are on the surface is because it's not necessary that they need to be satisfied. Their interactions entirely by other functional groups from the same protein molecule. Okay, because they're on the surface, right? They're exposed. Means that at least part of their surface is actually involved in interaction with the solvent or whatever is in the solvent. So, but what kind of, I don't understand what kind of stabilization. I mean, any molecule has to have a surface, right? Obviously, you have to have some functional groups which are on the surface, which are not satisfied their interactions entirely by the by intramolecular interactions. So they have to be intermolecular interactions in the end. So that could be ions in the solution. That could be other molecules in solution. So if it is soluble molecule, then basically there's a salt, counterions or water, or if it is an interacting protein, so then definitely the interacting partner, for example, DNA in the case of a histone.
Sir, can you exemplify it? Like, suppose we have a sequence and you fold it in like alpha helix manner.
Mm-hmm.
And then how can we locate those negative charges so that it is exposed to the outer environment? I can imagine that.
Yeah, so for example, if you take any of these molecules, okay? So you have a surface, right? You have a surface, okay? So where actually side chains are sticking out, right? But then they are not satisfied, means they are either interacting with water, okay? Or sometimes, for example, let's say in the case of bottom molecule, what I'm showing is DHFR. You have one thing in blue and one thing in red. So these are actually substrates. So these substrates are actually coming and interacting with whatever the surface provided by the side chains there. So if this substrate molecule is not there, those side chains are actually interacting with water. But if this substrate is molecule, then it actually it's interacting with those side chains. But those side chains could be charged or partially polar, or sometimes it could be hydrophobic, small patch might be exposed.
Okay.
So yes. That's the example I can give. Anything which is binding protein ligand interactions, or protein protein interactions, or enzymatic catalysis, okay, all these are satisfied. Or, for example, let's say if you have myoglobin or hemoglobin, okay, so then you have oxygen is selectively and coming and binding this iron, okay, but the other side, cysteine, is actually interacting with iron through SH. Okay.
Okay,
I think these are the examples I can give.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Okay, I hope that answers your question. Okay,
yes,
who is next?
Anyone? I have a question.
Yeah, go to sir.
Okay, sir. So according to sir, the Anfinsen's hypothesis, the native structure of a protein is determined by the uniqueness of its amino acid configuration.
Correct. Yes.
So if I have a proline, if I have a proline in my backbone, so it can have a cis or trans configuration. So how will it affect that protein folding?
No, that will affect the protein folding. So we need to know, for example, that prolines are actually again common. Okay. So in structures, we need to see that proline is in where it is in, first of all. Okay. Finally, in the native state, is it in the cis state or trans state? Okay, we need to find out because prolines are actually equally probable in cis and trans configurations. But let's see if it is in trans, in both native state and the denatured state, it's not going to affect much because it doesn't have to isomerize. There is something called proline isomerization. This change from cis to trans is called isomerization. There are enzymes, protein-based molecules, enzymes, which actually catalyze this reaction. Proline cis-trans isomerizations or isomerases. Okay, for example, what I'm showing here is a proline in beta 1 turn, type 1 and type 2 beta 2 beta turns, where actually proline is commonly occurs in the turn. Okay, the turn. Okay, you see the proline second residue, and proline should be okay. The second one is also should be supposed to be proline. Okay, it's glycine. Okay, let's say type one. Yeah. Okay, type one beta proline. So now let's say this proline is in trans. Okay, in native state, but somehow it is in cis in the denatured state. So then, because protein folding is typically faster than the isomerization, because this is literally a large rotation, okay? So which needs to be catalyzed because the barrier is very high. So this needs to be often catalyzed by enzymes, or sometimes it occurs by itself, but it's very slow rate, okay?
Okay.
Now, the problem is that only when your proline is in opposite conformations, in the native state and the denatured state. So then a proline isomerization is a limiting step for protein folding. But if it is in the same conformation, both in the native and denatured states, then that is not the rate limiting step in few words.
Okay. So, sir, another question.
Yeah.
Why do that chaperones and those lysosomal degradations cannot affect that beta amyloid formations?
See, chaperones are in intracellular systems. Beta amyloid aggregates actually form outside the cell. These are extracellular. So inside the brain, the amyloid plaques actually occur outside cells. So because amyloid beta is actually secreted outside, and it was supposed to be a membrane protein, then it is cleaved. So it floats in the outside cells and then it forms. But there are aggregates which are actually intracellular called synuclein. Synuclein is an intracellular aggregate. So when the aggregates are really big, you know, so your chaperones or recycling systems can help you if the work is minimal, right? If the work is too much, so then they will not be able to. So that's what really happens in this amyloidopathies or synucleopathies, where synuclein is an intracellular aggregator. So somehow the aggregates are so big that cells cannot really do anything. It's like beyond repair. But they try to tackle the problem as much as they can. They do really good job. Chaperones trying to solubilize proteins, make them fold. And if they're not really folding, then even smaller aggregates can be put into lysosome, pack into vesicles, change the pH, reduce them, lyse them into peptides so that they can use. But occasionally they are so big, enormous, that these machines will not come in handy. Okay.
Okay, so one last small question. Sir, the folded and unfolded conformations of protein, they generally differ marginally in their delta G values.
Correct. Yeah. I mean, compared to what? When you say marginal, means that you always need to compare with something. Then only you can say something is small or big, right? So compared to what, these are marginal. But you need to compare with.
So, sir, these are generally at normal physiological temperature and pH.
Hmm.
So when I have a fever, my body temperature increases. So is there any protein unfolding occurring in my body?
Okay. Do you know what is your body temperature? In, let's say, Celsius, what is your normal body temperature?
37 degrees centigrade.
Yeah, 37.4. Okay. Let's say when you have a fever, do you know what is your temperature?
Okay.
No. Yeah, I'm asking you a question.
In Fahrenheit, it's generally 98 is the normal one, and when fever, it goes to some 100 or 104.
Yeah, 100.
Okay, so actually, it's a small.
90. So 96 to basically, let's say about 101, 102, and rarely you go to 104. But that's in Fahrenheit. But in degree Celsius, can anyone tell me what is roughly the temperature? Converting 100, let's say 104 Fahrenheit to Celsius. Google.
Yes.
Anyone is checking? Can anyone let me know?
F minus that.
100 Fahrenheit equals to 2 Celsius, right?
40 degree.
Yeah, 40. Oh, it's good. Scale is there. Let's see if it is 100. Okay, so if it is 100, that itself is a fever, right? So that's your 37.7.
Okay.
So 96 is normal, right?
Okay.
So that's your 36. Okay. So let's see if you have 104, okay, really on high side. So that's your 37 to 40 degrees Celsius, 3 degrees Celsius.
Okay.
Means Kelvin is 2, so only 3 degree Kelvin is different. So that's a very small change in the temperature proteins to really aggregate. Imagine if something really happens in 3 degrees. I mean, if you have a fever for a day, then all your proteins are actually denatured. So we won't even survive. So the temperature is very small change, but yet that has huge effect on other bodily functions, but on an average, so proteins are not really affected to that effect in terms of, I mean, fraction. Very little. But yes, there might be small effect on the protein thing. But gene expression will be different. Different types of proteins will be there. So that's what really happens. But on an average, most of the proteins are actually stable enough when you have fever. Okay, who is next?
So just a bit of fancy, sir. If someone insert a hot air blower into someone's mouth for late 15 minutes,
which Netflix series or which Amazon Prime you are really watching? Okay, so put hot air, into someone's mouth for how long? For how long?
Okay.
No. For with fancy, it's okay. Go ahead. I'm sure others are also enjoying. Go ahead, Tushar. Tell me. Finish your question. You need to finish your question.
15 minutes, sir.
15 minutes?
To keep that hot.
Yeah. No. But what is the question? What are you trying to ask?
Go ahead, Tushar. This was not my question.
Tushar, you need to finish your question. I know. Recently, because I'm telling you, I have seen in some web series recently this, or in a movie, I don't remember. Literally.
Yeah. Yes, sir, it's in a web series.
Which one is that?
Mirzapur 2.
Mirzapur,
sir, Amazon Prime, Mirzapur 2. Second part of Mirzapur.
Okay. I definitely have not seen that, but something else I've seen. Okay. Yeah, but anyway, what is your question?
So, sir, can it cause protein defolding?
You're saying that what is a hot air temperature?
It will be generally 30 or 40 degree, perhaps.
What do you mean 40? Have you seen someone
drying
their hair with what is that? The hot air thing? It's not 40. It's much higher. Can anyone tell me what is roughly the temperature?
Around 80 degrees Celsius, maybe.
Around 80, yeah. It's very high. Okay, so depending on, of course, which button you're using, slow, fast, hot, okay? But then it's very hot and you're saying that you want to really pump that. So it's so hot that basically tissues die. Anything internal organs, wherever this air is going on, you know, your cells are destroyed. Okay, forget about proteins. We are not really talking about proteins.
Oh, okay.
We are talking about tissues. We are talking about cells. And then only comes molecules. But all the tissues are actually going to be affected so much that internal burns, you know, it's like burning. Okay, so which damage your tissues. And then, yeah, if it is long enough, people die.
Yes.
Okay, good. Okay.
Okay, so thank you.
Yeah.
Sir, I have a question.
Okay, Pratip, wait a minute. Who said Simran? You have a question?
Sir, I have a question.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Sir, yeah, go ahead.
This in beta turn, we can beta. There are 4 amino acids in a turn.
Uh-huh, yeah, which constitute the turn, yes.
Means there are 4 residues per turn. So,
yeah.
In alpha helix, there are only 3.6 residues per turn. So, the dihedral angles here must be different from the turn in the alpha helix.
Mm-hmm.
So, what is the driving force? Why it doesn't form the same type of a turn as we see in the alpha helix?
Okay.
Same dihedral.
Yeah, so that's because of the proline.
Same 3.6 residues.
Yeah, yeah. So you can ask question that what happens if I put let's say a helix in a helix, what happens if I put a proline? Okay. So we said that proline cannot really have the right dihedral angles. Okay. So right dihedral angles. So to satisfy that helix, okay, where is the Ramachandran plot? Okay, so that's in the next slideshow. Okay, which one is this? Okay, 6 to 8. So it should be here, no? Ramachandran plot. Okay. For example, here, so alpha helix, actually right-handed helix is here. Okay, so you need to have all phi psi for all amino acids in this region to form helix. But the proline cannot really, see, if you see the polyprolines, okay? So polyprolines come somewhere here, okay? Whether it is cis or trans, you know? So basically their phi psi want to be somewhere in this region. So this one is what? For psi is actually minus 150-ish. But here it is alpha helix, psi is minus 50. Okay, so plus 150, minus 50. So this is a huge change, right? So this change cannot really occur in proline. So that's why prolines cannot be in helices. Okay. On the other hand, beta turns, okay, beta turns. So this proline, this phi and psi actually helps to have a sharp turn here. Okay. Which is not really possible in helices. There are 2 ways to think. One, what happens if I put a proline in alpha helix, so then helix cannot really propagate because that it disrupts that helical 1 to 4 hydrogen bond. Okay, but on the other hand, it has a different way of forming hydrogen bond by sharply turning somewhere here, okay, in beta turn. So here, any other amino acid would have little difficulty, but proline would be ideal. In alpha helix, any other amino acid is okay, but except proline. So that's 2 ways to answer.
Okay. So if by chance there is not a proline, but some other amino acid present, so it will be slightly different and the hydrogen bonding in beta sheets will be destroyed.
Correct. So because then a sharp turn might not be possible. So you might have actually few amino acids forming a loop or something, but which are not stabilized because you don't have stabilization energy. But if you want a sharp turn, so then proline is actually ideal. Let me see what is type 1 and type 2 beta turns are most common. Type 1 occur more than twice as frequently as type 2. Type 2 beta turns usually have glycine as third residue, okay? So because it is a short chain, okay? Because you don't want to have really large chain.
Yeah, more flexible.
Yeah. So one is to have flexibility, so glycine. But to assist a turn, proline. Proline actually assists. So that's why you see even the occurrence. Type 1 turns occur more than twice as frequently as type 2. Means it shows that, so beta turns, if you want to stabilize, okay, of course, the stabilization comes from after the propagation of the hairpin. But you need to initiate that, okay? So that initiation and stabilization is ideal if you have a proline. But next best is glycine. But other amino acids having this will be less likely. It's possible because if you imagine if you have a beta sheet is much long, then of course, then they can actually form. But then you might not have a sharp turn, but you might have a slightly long turn where the hydrogen bonding might not be satisfied even between 1 and 4. That's okay. Okay, so for example, 1, 2, 3, 4. So between 1 and 4, then might not be, additional residue will be there. But sharp turns, prolines are ideal. Next best, glycines. That's why prolines and glycines, you don't want to be in helices. Because in helices, proline definitely will not satisfy the phi and psi, because psi cannot really go plus 150 to minus 50. But again, glycine is too flexible. Those are the reasons.
So if glycine...
Does that answer your question, Simran? Yeah?
I got it. But I have another question now. If glycine is flexible, so I have read that means when glycine is in alpha helix, there is more loss of entropy for glycine. That's why it doesn't prefer to be in alpha helix. Sir, when we are talking about loss of entropy, with what with respect to what we are talking for glycine?
No, loss of entropy means that, let's say if molecule can be in, okay. So any secondary structural element, fixed means, okay, can you guys hear me? It says my internet connection is unstable. Yes. Okay, So what is the meaning of secondary, well-defined secondary structural elements? Means that you are actually having only one conformations. Means that your entropy is low.
Yes.
Right. That's not a good thing, you know. So you need to, because entropy is low, it is stabilized by further other interactions, okay? But let's say if molecule can be in conformations, okay? It can have really high number of conformations with the similar bonding, you know? So the molecule should actually prefer. So what happens with glycine is that the chain is so flexible, okay? So it can actually attain other globular conformations, which are more collapsed than any non-glycine peptides, okay? So that's why I like to show this Ramachandran plot, if it is there. So this is for the glycine, okay, if I remember correctly. Yeah, glycine. So basically, if you see, the glycine actually can go almost anywhere on the Ramachandran plot. Unlike other amino acids, you know, so they sparsely populate. That's because the moment you, this is for alanine, okay, by the way, the moment you have slightly bulky chain, irrespective of whether it is hydrophobic or hydrophilic, you can't have flexible phi and size. Okay, conformations are actually reduced. Means that your entropy is low. But glycine, okay, because of the hydrogen, it can really have all possible phi and psi, means that entropy is high, right? So now if you restrict that to only alpha helix, which belong to only this corner, or beta sheet only this corner, then you are actually reducing, okay, its conformational entropy. So that's against, because with the same, it can have the same enthalpic interactions anywhere else if glycine is there. But at the same time, it can have more conformations. So that's why glycine or polyglycine doesn't want to attain a single conformation, but yet collapsed a conformationally heterogeneous system, okay, satisfying or having phi and psi to a larger extent. Okay, but the moment you replace next complex amino acid, glycine to alanine, just because of that small bulkiness, now most of the space is actually not accessible, because those phi psi are not possible because of the steric clash between the methyls. So that's why you are restricting. So that's why actually they tend to attain either this shape or this shape. But the polyglycine, on the other hand, it does. When it doesn't really attain any well-defined shape, its entropy is high. So basically further stabilization. So entropic stabilization in the collapsed state. So that's the reason why glycine or polyglycine is a slightly special case, and then people often use entropic argument. Entropic arguments is because mainly it can have a large space of phi and psi. Okay, Simra, that addresses
yes,
your question.
Yes,
okay.
Sir, one more question. Why is uranose form of ribose is present and not the pyranose form in nucleic acids?
I lost you. You need to repeat.
Yeah.
I lost. You need to repeat your question.
Yeah. Can you hear me now?
Better. Yes.
Okay. So in nucleic acids, why we have a furanose form of ribose and not the pyranose form?
What is difference between furanose and pyranose?
Pyranose form, it's six-membered and it's more stable as compared to furanose form, which is five-membered.
Okay, that's a good question. This one, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So what happens if you try to make six-membered ring?
So the CH2, which is now on the fifth carbon, it will also will be the part of ring, and we'll have six-membered ring instead of five-membered ring in furans.
Okay. So I think, if I remember correctly, when I read Leninger, it says for mononucleic acids, okay, so where the connectivity is, it's only one nucleotide, okay, so when it is not really propagating on either side as a polynucleotide, so then I think it exists in both 5 and 6, if I remember correctly, okay, but the moment you put polynucleotide, okay, so then actually somehow this five-membered ring structure is more stable. Okay, why? I don't know actually.
Means we want stability or we want flexibility?
No. In the end, it is actually the global minimum of free energy, lowest free energy conformation, whatever you get. That's the thermodynamic principle.
Sir, can I make a point here?
Yeah. Okay, go ahead.
Sir, I think if the ring size becomes six member, the size will be much more than this five member ring. So the steric fit will not be attained then. If the structure is again still the alpha, the double stranded DNA structure.
No, are you saying it will still form double stranded DNA or not?
No. I am saying if the structure go to the furanose form to the pyranose form, then the steric fit will not be attained anymore to attain this DNA double helix structure. Maybe that constrained the ring into a five member then to become a six member.
Yeah. So I don't know the answer, but let me open Leninger. I remember I read somewhere this. Yeah, meanwhile, others can actually discuss or ask questions. So let me try to see. I read this somewhere, but I don't remember. I think it's Leninger. Why the search fee? I don't know why the search feature is not working. Ah, it's working, it's working. Yeah. Okay. Not this. Okay, so because I'm using Zoom, this is slow. Somewhere in the nucleosides, I have carbohydrates. What chapter is DNA?
So can I make a comment here about this sugar thing?
Go ahead, Gil. Please go ahead.
Yes. Yeah, so the pyranose form, that is the six-membered form, it is generally attained by the sugars which have six carbons in it. Then the furanose form is generally attained by this. For example, glucose. Glucose is a sugar which has six carbons in it.
Yeah.
So it can take the glucocapyranose form. But let's say in case of the ribose sugar, it's like a five-membered ring. So if it wants to form like a ring kind of structure, I think the most stable structure will be the five-membered one, not the six-membered one. This is from basic organic chemistry.
Okay. My computer is damn slow. Yeah. Guys, you discuss, just don't wait and stare at my screen. But yeah, it's a discussion class, so you go ahead. It's not that I answer questions, but now we have read and attended classes, so you should be able to discuss. So I'm just trying to see which chapter is DNA. Someone is walking, some gurgling sound. Okay, so okay, I think this is what thing. Okay, conformation of ribose in solution, the straight chain aldehyde and ring are forms are in equilibrium. Okay, this is even revealing. See that this is what it says, that if you have conformation of ribose alone, so in solution, the straight chain aldehyde and rings are equilibrium. RNA contains only the ring form, beta D ribofuranose, deoxyribofuranose, similar conformation, okay, in solution. But in DNA exists solely as this. Okay, I think this is what I remember. So Simran, that's what you're asking, right? Why can't have a different conformation for sugar? Simran?
Yeah.
So I think this is what I remember.
Yes, sir. But pyranose form, six-membered.
Yeah, but question is that other forms rather than five-membered ring. Okay.
Maybe so this phosphate linking will not be that much easier to grow in if it is six-membered.
Also, six-membered is common to the to carbohydrates which have six carbons in it. And ribose is a pentose sugar.
No, pentose means what? Okay, five member ring. Okay.
Because, the number of carbon atoms.
I see. Yeah. So in the linear form, I see only five carbons, or four carbons and one oxygen in this. Okay. But the question is that here they are saying that it can be in linear form, you know, in free ribose. But let's say if it is in RNA, and it's only in the ring form. Okay, but again, DNA. Yeah, it says that
of the groups, because one is attached to base and one is attached to phosphate.
Correct.
So reactivities are changed, so it cannot revert back to the strip.
Sugars, this is a funny thing. They can have actually linear forms. Okay, so we think that six-membered rings are six-membered rings. No, but they are in equilibrium with linear chains in solution. Okay, so that's even much more problematic. Okay, so yeah, I think Simran, I'm sorry, that's the answer. But I don't know why it doesn't really reconvert. Here also, it doesn't really say.
Sir, when these RNA or DNAs are formed, if we can get to that mechanism, how it forms, then we can probably comment on this question. Let's say if we have a straight chain sugar first, and then let's say the phosphates and base are attached to it, then it will undergo a certain kind of folding. Another possibility is that the straight chain sugar first forms a ring, and then these phosphates and bases are attached to it. So my idea is that we need to know how these DNA chains or RNA chains are formed. If we can look into that, then probably we will be able to answer this question.
No, it could be very simple, no? So you might have sugar, and then maybe bases are attached, and then phosphates, I guess. Because once one phosphate is attached, then I know how the other phosphates are attached. For example, like adenosine monophosphate, okay, versus adenosine diphosphate. Or adenosine triphosphate, ATP, ADP, AMP. So where actually phosphates are attached and removed, that's easier, right? That itself is energetic. That's where actually most of the energy is coming from. That's what we call ATP to ADP. That cleaving one phosphate group will give you energy.
I think that glucose is getting first attached to phosphate bond. So that the OH is no longer will be an active participant. So that's why the another oxygen, which is available at the carbon above, will form the five member ring. So no possibility of six member ring. If it has to form, then it has to form like five, six, seven, eight member ring. Then seven member ring then, instead of getting six member ring.
Where are the seven atoms to mob the?
I'm saying that if we draw the reaction mechanism, then if we attach the phosphate to the fifth carbon atom, to the blue CH2OH, okay, so then if it has to cyclize to the carbonyl-carbon, then how many, then what will be the ring size then?
No, it's exactly same thing, right? For example, like you guys are seeing my screen, right? So 8.3... You see CH2OH is free. In below, you see that AMP, the CH2 phosphate is attached to CHT. So this OH, a CH2OH, is actually free in all cases. You know, that's independent of the ring formation, right? What are involved in the ring, that CH2OH is actually not part of the linear ring. So that OH is free.
That's what I'm saying. If we have to propose the mechanism for this six-member ring to form, then we can say that why it's not forming, because the phosphate is forming first at the primary carbon atom.
Okay.
Then if we have to draw the six-member, then it's not possible. Yeah.
It's protected in a sense.
Because there is it will be protected. Then it will be seven-membered ring. So if we have to give the mechanism for the this reaction, then we can say that first the phosphate is getting attached to the primary carbon here because of the maybe steric reason, it's not going to anywhere. So and then the whole cyclization is only possible through the carbon above it, and the five member ring will form.
Yeah, but anyway, so that's definitely yes. So once you attach something to CH2, I agree that it's not CH2OH, it's CH2O, let's say phosphate. Yeah, but someone also pointed out that, so what you see in 8.3 here figure, so it's a linear form versus five member ring, you know. So this never really forms six member ring. I think that's one question I think we solved. So only, I mean, six carbon chains only can form six membered ring. Basically, you have five carbons in the chain plus one oxygen. Yes, here it is. It's so this even in the free form, it doesn't form six membered ring.
Yeah, one point I'm getting now, that if we attach the phosphorus to the six membered ring, then it will have only 360 degree rotation to it, the phosphorus. So yeah. And if it is attached to CH2OH, the entropy will be like more here than the previous one. Then we can also give the entropical reason also. That's what I'm thinking.
Entropic reason. But anyway, so first of all, what we have seen is that this CH2, I think that was a similar question to begin with. So just a minute. So Sivran's question was that this CH2, which is seems to be free outside, why not it will be part of the ring? So that's actually doesn't form even in the free sugar form. If you take furanose, you know, it's always five membered ring. It will never really form six membered ring. So, but it can form linear chain. Okay. So in the free sugar, only sugar. But the moment you attach something, let's say CH2OH or to CH2 phosphate, so looks like this conversion between linear and ring structure is kind of tilted towards ring only. Okay, that's why it says that in RNA and DNA, it's always a ring form, but not the linear chain. Okay. Yes, someone?
Sujit? Sir, in this, if we are seeing the furanose structure here in a planar model, if we go to the Packard model and do the conformation analysis, I think then that question can be answered why furanose ribose is forming a furanose form even in the naked solution state. If we go through the conformation analysis of six-member chair form and in the five-member envelope-like structure, then the 1,3 diacyl interactions can be play a crucial role for their stability.
What interactions?
1,3 diacyl interactions, which occurs in the six-member rings, and if the atoms remains in axial position.
Okay.
I think that can be a crucial factor for their forming as five-member or six-member kind of things.
Okay. Yeah, I'm not really sure. It's a long ago that I read sugar chemistry. So, you're saying that some 1,3 interactions in six member. Okay, I don't know much, but I think that's briefly I can answer is that. So definitely, yeah, it's no six member ring for furanose, but not even linear chain, which is possible for naked sugars. Okay, next question.
I have a small question, sir.
Yeah.
Regarding splicer enzyme.
Yeah.
Sir, from the beginning of this biochemistry course, I was thinking.
So who is asking? Who is asking?
Sanjeev, sir. It's Sanjeev.
Sanjeev. Okay.
So from the beginning, I was means what the thing which differentiate one cell to another cell from a liver cell to a lung cell. So I was just simplifying the whole, means picturizing the whole thing and trying to. Then you said about the splicer enzyme. Okay, sir.
Yeah. Okay. Splicing. Okay. Gene splicing. Okay.
Pre-mRNA splicer enzyme. So for a particular protein to be synthesized, there should be one particular that splicer enzyme. Is it correct, sir?
No, I think there are different things. I think a little bit confused because you are talking about cells and different types of cells.
No.
You are saying different types of proteins.
A simple thing. Let me simple put it a little bit. Means a particular protein to be synthesized, we need a set of codons in the mRNA.
Correct.
Okay. So to acquire that set of codons, we need a splicer enzyme. We need the splicing process for which the splicer enzyme is the reason for the whole thing, splicing thing is happening. Okay, sir.
Splicing comes after codons. Codons code for certain, let's say, amino acids. Okay, so that okay, codons will give information to translate to mRNA. That's it, pre-mRNA. But after
pre-mRNA, after two process, mRNA. The pre-mRNA
becomes mRNA.
Yeah, so we need that splicer enzyme.
Enzyme, yeah.
Okay. I'm saying that for one particular protein, is there any particular splicing enzyme needed to form that particular sequence?
No. So basically, these splicers are spliceosomes. Okay, these are enzyme complexes. They don't even worry about proteins. They are actually working with only RNA molecules. But somehow they recognize that certain elements. Okay, so they recognize and then they chop off a small segment of that mRNA and then they stitch the cut ends together. Okay, how do they do? We don't know how exactly they detect. Because mRNA is mRNA, right? Sequence of bases. But suddenly it says that, okay, this codon should not code for amino acids. So we need to remove. The next codon is also not required. Like that, they need to know a stretch of multiples of three bases. Okay.
Yeah.
And then it says that you need to cut this. This is not really important. Cut and then paste. How exactly it does is a mystery. We don't know.
How exactly does, I'm not asking that.
Worried. Okay.
That, for a particular, particular protein to synthesis, we need a particular mRNA, one sequence of our mRNA. Okay,
correct,
sir.
Correct.
So, from to make the mRNA from pre-mRNA, we need to cut at a specific position in the pre-mRNA.
Correct.
Will be done by the splicer enzyme. Okay.
Uh-huh.
So I am saying that because there are only the interaction means all the ionic interaction, hydrophobic interaction, and all these interaction which are the reason for the particular splicing enzyme to find where it have to cut the whole thing.
Mm-hmm.
So I am saying that one protein is will it correspond to one splicer enzyme or there will be?
Question, I understand. Is it like somehow you're thinking like say, there are let's say 1,000 proteins in the cell. Is it that like you have 1,000 spliceosomes because that's a lot of cost, right? Okay, first of all, it's not that all proteins do they have a pre-mRNA form. Okay, only large proteins. Okay. So I would say maybe not substantially large amount, okay? But certain proteins which need to be really long, okay, will have multiple things. But I presume that it's not that every protein needs to have a spliceosome, but maybe only one or two classes of spliceosomes are good enough to sort all pre-mRNA to mRNA. You don't have to have for every protein corresponding to a spliceosome, no. Different set of proteins, no. Because they have to work with only four different types of bases, right? So I'm sure a couple of spliceosomes are good enough for all proteins.
Okay,
for spliceosome. So we don't even actually bring the word protein because the spliceosome doesn't care about the protein. It says that I have mRNA sequence where I need to cut and paste, simple. Okay.
So
I would think that there are a couple of classes. It doesn't have to be very large.
Yes. Actually, from the beginning of class, I was just trying to figure out how we can differentiate one cell from just these are the general points, sir.
Yeah, but that's what I'm telling you. So this question is different from the other. How you differentiate one cell from the other cell is DNA is identical.
DNA is identical, except
RBCs, which doesn't have nucleus. DNA is identical, but which genes are expressed? Is very crucial for every cell type or every tissue. What genes are expressed? So two words are important here: spatiotemporal. Means that it's not that it's lung tissue doesn't mean that all proteins are expressed all the time. No, again, state of the cell. Spatiotemporal, sometimes it's time dependent, you know.
Yes, sir.
Sometimes it's location dependent. Even within the tissue, I would presume that the cells on the peripheral of tissue somehow have a differential expression than the cells which are core of the tissue.
Okay.
Possibility, you know, because the nutrients might be different at the
Yes, sir. You already explained these things in the previous class also. Sir, I was thinking that how that time dependence come into that chromosomes thing.
So that's very simple. So that's where actually the whole world called signal transduction. You know, so how does cell know that, for example, let's say I have just eaten food, the sugar, a lot of sugar is available in my food, it needs to be absorbed. Means that you have to tell someone, all the cells, that hey, go and grab your sugar. Okay, how is it done? A modulator, insulin, a molecule which is floating in the blood serum, says that hey, a lot of sugar, and it will knock every cell's door by binding to insulin receptor, says that knock, you take glucose, okay, like that.
Yes,
so like these molecules, it could be peptides, this is hormones, okay, insulin is basically peptide hormone, but it could be small molecules, a lot of other times just small molecules, okay. So these are called messengers, and there are different classes of messengers, okay, primary messengers, secondary messengers, okay. So these messengers can be extracellular, it can be intracellular, but however, whether it is extracellular or intracellular, signaling happens from the outside cell to the inside cell. Like insulin binds on the other outside of the cell to a receptor, but every information is actually transduced into the cell, inside the cell, so that the machinery inside the cell makes more glucose importers and then recruit them to membrane. So basically messengers, signals transduction, messengers are the keywords.
So there are lots of many other...
lot of messengers.
That's why we are going
all to... All small molecules which bind, push, pull, okay, are messengers. And enzymatic class is very small. Most of the time it's actually message.
Yes, sir. Another question. This ATP. ATP means the energy which is drives from the glucose. It used for so many process like the movement of the mRNA in the ribosome.
Correct.
And that cargo movement from the actin filament.
Yes.
So how does this ATP is means again there will be some lots of other molecules.
So ATP, there is some, okay. So briefly, maybe we'll teach one day, because without actually studying ATP energy, biochemistry course is not complete. Okay. So ATP, adenosine triphosphate, you have three phosphates. What I'm showing here is actually AMP, adenosine monophosphate. But if you add two more phosphates, it's ATP. But if you cleave the third phosphate, okay, and it becomes ADP. So the cleaving that third phosphate releases a lot of energy. Means you are actually breaking a phosphate oxygen bond.
I got that point, sir.
So but what cleaves that is there is something called ATPase. ATPases. ATPase bind ATP and then cleaves this ATP to ADP plus PI. And then that energy which is released is stored in a mechanical form in that protein now. Enzyme, okay. So that enzyme now actually can do kickboxing, okay, at the molecular level, okay.
Yeah.
Now, wherever you need ATP energy conversion, you add ATPase. You know, molecular motors, they have actually a lot of ATPase domains on their legs. You know, so they bind ATP. ADP conversion gives a small kick, and then molecule actually changes conformational change in a way. And then that mechanical energy further pushes to whatever it's supposed to do. Most of the places wherever ATP energy is utilized, you have ATPase. ATPase, that chemical energy which is released because of this reaction, is stored in a mechanical form, okay, in that protein, a domain, okay, which further conformational changes will allow transduce that mechanical energy into work. For example, like I mentioned chaperones, right?
There
is like football shaped molecules. They have a lot of ATPase domains there on the surface. So the molecule inside this chaperone, okay, needs to be unfolded mechanically. It means that it's clump form, but not rightly folded. So you need to unravel these interactions. Okay, that basically that needs to come a barrier, a potential barrier. Okay,
the
barrier. Where does that energy comes? That energy comes from ATP. But ATP, the molecule themselves cannot really absorb that energy. So this chaperones have ATPase domains. So ATP hydrolysis will actually do a lot of conformational changes on this. These are molecules are really dynamic, you know, literally sometimes movement of a small domain like this. Okay, so these large changes at the molecular level, okay, transduce into that molecule which is actually attached onto the surface. It says that fractionally they actually broken some interactions. Now the molecule has a chance to readjust those interactions like that. Okay, so that's why any process which requires ATPases, they have different ATP cycles. Means that it's not just one ATP molecule will be converted into successfully to use. Most of the time, actually, this energy doesn't really go in a not completely utilized. So you have actually more ATP molecules. So that's why you call ATP cycles. Okay, how many cycles the ATP is, so that you have a lot of ATP molecules in the end, tiny, tiny, tiny amounts of work, okay, can be done at the molecular level. So that's why people call proteins are actually is nano machines. Okay. Okay, now actually we are kind of 1:30. Any guys who haven't asked questions can ask. This is your only chance.
Sir, because, I have questions.
Yes, Prateep.
Sorry, sir. One small point, sir. Sorry, Prateep. Just one small. Sir, this is the last, means don't we have another session for the question?
Well, if it is required, yeah, next class also we can take, but I'm not sure. Yeah, maybe next class also we can take.
Yeah, okay. Next class should be.
Okay.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. Yes,
sir. I have a couple of questions. So
yeah, go ahead.
So, sir, first the general question that so why, sir, ATP, not the GTP, CTP, they can also give the energy. So why the ATP?
So basically, that's question is very good. So basically, yes, the cleavage is only phosphate bond. You are absolutely right, because that bond is where the energy is coming. But somehow these molecules which recognize this substrate, so somehow they are adapted to this adenosine moiety. Okay, so the difference between ATP and GTP is basically adenosine versus guanosine, right? So somehow ATPases are actually recruited because they recognize this. And yes, there is GDP to GMP is also actually happens. Okay. So, but this is very rare, but most of the energy is actually derived this. So you don't want to have redundant in making this, but systems actually adapted one molecule. Yeah, because otherwise energy is coming from the phosphate cleavage. So that's nothing to do with adenosine. You're right. But I think over the evolution, somehow they developed only one. But otherwise, in principle, it's possible that you can have. Yeah. Imagine, let's say, if you take ATPase and then let's say somehow modify the adenosine detecting domain to make it G detecting domain, then you have actually GMPase, a GDP, GTPase.
Yes, so maybe possible in any other species. So, sir, my next question is, so, sir, if we, general question it is also, sir, when we import a molecular medicine, let's say, for a vitamin, so when we use it from the natural source and give the body, so we see that it is more helpful on this, or if we that obtain from the chemical synthesis. Let's say we purify extremely and synthesize and give the body. So even the molecule is same, so it came from chemical lab and the one is from the nature. So how the body distinguish these molecules? Because then how the our molecules cannot do the same type of like than the nature's vitamins or nature's molecules?
No, they are more. Yeah, so I think your question is that if I put it in my own words or paraphrase. So let's say if you have a molecule, what are the molecules to chemists? So set of atoms which are have a connectivity, okay, defined connectivity. So that connectivity, if you achieve through a test tube or through a biological cell, it's exactly the same. It's the biological cell is not going to care. I'll give you one example. Insulin, you know, so in 60s and 70s, okay, before protein engineering era, where actually we were not able to, because we didn't know even codons, how to synthesize proteins, where is the information there. So we used to purify insulin, you know, for the diabetic patients. Where the insulin was coming, you know, it was coming from pigs. So literally you kill pigs and then purify insulin and then use that insulin, okay? But over decades with the developments in protein engineering, now actually we produce insulin, okay, in labs without even using any life form. And these insulin injections work as well. So body doesn't really care if the molecule is exactly same connectivity as whether it is you achieve synthetic route or biological route. Body absolutely doesn't really differentiate that. Okay, because it doesn't really recognize whether something is purified in a test tube, in a synthesis, or something produced. But what makes difference is this. Let's say impurities. So sometimes, you know, modifications to molecules. So if you use biological route, often, you know, you get actually pure product. Because biological machines are very precise, so they don't really make errors. For example, like ribosomes, the error rate is very low. But if you have to synthesize the same molecule, protein molecule inside the test tube, errors will be huge. Then you have actually very small fraction which are not right molecules. Now, if you assume that that's 100% pure and if you give it to biological cell, of course, cell will react differently because it's seeing some molecules differently. That's the reason. Okay. So otherwise, if molecules, somehow you guarantee that you purified in test tube and I purified from bacteria, if they're identical, cell is not going to make any difference. It's not going to make any difference to biological cells.
Okay, sir. And sir, and the next question is, sir, DNA is different for different persons. So, sir, can we say that RNA is also different for different persons because RNA is synthesized by DNA?
No, no. So what you need to understand when we say our genetic makeup is different is that our genes are different, you know. But see, most of the genes, I mean, especially which are coding for protein molecules, okay, they are more or less need to be identical because otherwise the protein makeup is not really different, okay. But how these information, most of the information actually, which is difference is coming from the non-coding region, you know, how that translates to is actually what we don't know. For example, let's say the ATP which I digest in my cells has ATPase domain. The ATP which digests in your cells has ATPase domain. They are identical, you know. Okay, but what is different is basically non-coding regions of DNA is different between you and me. Or how these genes, certain genes are actually arranged might be slightly different. But otherwise, all the functional genes, you know, most of the time I'm talking about, okay, not 100%, but I would say 95% to 99% need to be identical. Otherwise, we wouldn't be really doing all the molecular level functions because most of the molecular level functions which happens in you and me are identical.
Yes,
but
sir,
so the differences are actually how different number of cells, how these small changes in large scale tissues is actually making you and me different from each other. But that's coming from the mostly from the non-coding regions. How that arises, we don't know.
Yes, yes, that's so. Because DNA is different, so if they synthesize, then how the RNA or RNA is or the coding portion is same. That's the
thing. So, the protein making machines, okay?
So, there may be some sort of breaking the even law of.
Any small changes in spatio-temporal level is actually going to make huge difference on long term. How that builds up is what we don't know. You know, most of the functional genes, let me tell you, functional genes are need to be identical. Okay, so imagine, let's say if during this genetic reshuffling, if ATPase is messed up, then cells even won't even survive. Right, forget about building organisms. Okay, so that's why any errors which are in the functional genes. These are called genetic diseases sometimes, you know. So they are detrimental, but rarely that occur, you know, in terms of fraction. So that's why most of the changes, when you see your genes are different from my genes, it's basically mostly how this changes the non-coding regions, you know.
Okay, sir.
So you know what is the percentage, a fraction of genome which actually codes for proteins? Anyone? Please. Guys?
Sir, can you repeat that?
What is a fraction of your genome which codes for proteins? Open to all. You can go to Google and search as well. That's okay. What are the fraction of gene? What is the fraction of genome in our chromosomes, which actually really codes for proteins in the end, which work?
Somewhere between 1 to 5%.
Yes. Okay. So let's say about on higher side 5%. So you have 95% of your DNA sequence, which doesn't code for proteins directly, but which is there. Okay. How exactly that's making the differences between you and me? That's what we say our genes are different. Is the changes are actually occur in that 95%. Very minimal changes occur in this 5%, because in this 5%, you don't want to mess up any of your proteins. Definitely not. Okay? Any changes in these proteins will be detrimental. We won't even survive at cellular stage. Forget about developmental stages. So any changes, when we say gene shuffling, from the combining, reshuffling during meiosis, mitosis, you name it, all these gene shuffling businesses, most of the time, the changes occur in 96%. Okay, so when they say DNA fingerprinting to find out biological parents, they are actually looking at the sequences in the non-coding regions, but definitely not in the coding regions. If they see the protein sequence, they might be identical, right? If they look at, let's say, insulin sequence, it will be identical whether the gene of insulin, it's identical between you and me. The gene of ATPase is identical between you and me. Okay, the gene of glucose importer is identical between you and me, right? So they have to really look for positions where the changes are expected. That's actually in this 96%. So still a lot is known. So we still don't know what's exactly this 96% of DNA is really actually important for us. It's a issue. It's a big bioinformatics study. This are going on. Sir, okay, what else?
Sir, I have two more questions.
Yeah.
So, sir, okay. The
yeah, go ahead, Prateek.
Yes, sir. The splicing is occurring with the RNA. So then there is a part of exon and intron, as you say. So when they cut it and omit exon, so then the intron part, they also combine together or they wasted?
No, intron parts are the thrown away. They are not combined. Only exons are combined.
Okay, okay. And sir, next question is, sir, a protein, for a protein in the three-dimensional or quaternary structure, it needs a certain pH and some sort of water molecules. So, sir, who governs that how many water molecules and what pH will be there in the protein so that it stay in the stable form and do its work?
What do you mean number of water molecules?
Well, number of water molecules means water molecule, number of water molecules, not say water molecules, any like any when besides a protein or some sort, let's say forget the water molecule, let's say pH.
Mm-hmm.
So every protein in a stable form, there is a pH control. So now if the pH will change, then the protein will change and occur that way. So who says how the pH will be stay the same when the protein is not working or it is in a non-active form?
Pradeep, your question is, first of all, not very, pretty well, man, I'm confused. pH inside the cell or outside the cell is tightly regulated, doesn't change much. 7.4, 7.4.
No, no, sir. Let's say A protein and a B protein. Let's say A protein work in a pH 5.
Okay.
Just assume. And B protein work in a pH 12.
Okay.
So now when the A protein should work in the pH 5, so how the pH 5 or pH 12 occurred from the pH 7 or...
So anything in biology, if you want to segregate, so you have compartmentalization. For example, lysosome, where actually protein degradation occurs, these are membrane-bound compartments. Okay, inside the cell. So now it is membrane bound, you can actually selectively change pH inside. Or you have mitochondria, membrane bound organelle. You can have slightly different pH inside. So that's how actually you change the pH. If you want to change pH, simply make a membrane vesicle inside cells. And then inside the membrane vesicle, you can actually pack molecules, increase concentration, change pH.
Sir, what you say?
Mitochondria.
So there will be different pH and the average of the pH.
Mitochondria in inside slightly different pH than cytosolic pH. Lysosomes definitely acidic pH.
Is there any molecule that
HCl? There are proton pumps. You know. So they actually import protons, okay, in one direction. So that, okay, so because these are the pumps, you know, so they drive. Okay, you have a hand pump, right? When you pump, why the water actually coming from the ground to the top? From the below the ground to the top? Because you're pumping, right?
Yes.
You don't pump, the water doesn't come. It stays, actually it's stable in the below ground, right? But actually you're doing this, okay, means you're spending energy. Like this, these are proton pumps which embedded in membranes. They drive protons across gradients, okay? So proton pumps, that's a simple answer.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Okay, I don't think anyone else has any questions. It's already 1:30. So next class also we will continue. Then after that we'll resume our... regular classes. Okay. Wednesday also we'll have the same session. Okay, thank you. But come up with good formulated questions, then we can discuss. It's not that I only answer the questions, but people can answer questions others. Okay. Okay. Make it in a discussion mode next time. Okay, bye-bye.
Bye, sir. Thank you.